Hello and welcome to the second part of the presentation entitled the inverse Laplace transformations partial fractions expansion part 2 in this case. Without further ado, let's proceed and just recall the outcomes of this series of presentation, two of them. We said this was to give us the ability to be able to expand the rational expressions using partial fractions and handle both improper and the proper algebraic rational fractions in the process of expanding them into partial fractions. And this presentation in particular is going to focus on the second bullet where we are dealing with improper fractions. I'm not going to go through this in detail. Recall that this was the process we discussed before, which is the process of migrating a time differential equation, an initial value problem, into its frequency domain version and then solving it in this way. At this stage, we'll say we have solved the equation in the frequency domain. Now, if you look, reflect on the process of solving differential equations using Laplace transformation, it consists exactly in migrating the differential equation to the frequency domain and in the frequency domain is solving the version of the differential equation there using algebraic manipulation skills. That's what's done here, and the equation is solved there. And then from there, what will be necessary is to transform this rational expression into, actually decompose it into its partial fractions, which look more or less like the Laplace transforms which appear on the table, and they also use the combination of properties like the exponential shift theorem to solve the initial value problem. So this is what we had as our examples. We dealt with the first example. We managed to find our y of t. Now we're going to focus on the second example, which is R of S is equal to this rational expression. Again, to remind you that at this stage now, what we need to find the time domain signal R of T. That's our unknown. But of course, I've described the route to learn through that. So I'm not going to go to the solution which you looked at. You can revisit the video and go through and make sure that you understand it in preparation of understanding what I'm going to present now. And very important also, I would like to comment on the process of actually taking an expression like this in terms of S, which we take as a Laplace transform, which does not resemble anything which is on the table, and transforming it in such a way that it ends up looking more or less like a transform which is on the table, which might need the properties like exponential transform, exponential shift theorem, which we have here, which we can use in combination with our expansion here in order to solve the problem. So now let's look at the example which we're going to focus on. So this is example. The first thing to note now here is that this is an improper fraction. Remember I said a rational fraction like this is improper whenever the degree of the numerator is greater or equal to the degree of the polynomial in the denominator. So let's proceed to solving this problem. This is what we have. So we simply can write that. So we have our RS equal to 5x s squared plus 3s plus 2 over s squared plus 2s plus 3. So now that we note that this is an improper fraction, I'll recall what I said yesterday. I gave an example of a 7 over 4 as an improper arithmetic fraction, which we can actually represent in the form 1 plus 3 over 4, which we normally write as a mixed number as 1 and 3 quarters. For us to get to this kind of expression, what we need to do, we need to divide 7 by 4 and you get 1 and the remainder of 3 and then we write that. That's exactly the strategy we need to apply in order to proceed in this kind of situation. In that case, this part of the improper fraction is one which, where possible, we're going to need to do the decomposition into, or the expansion into, partial fractions. So now we're getting this ready for finding our time signal. So the first thing here is to do exactly what I've said, divide the numerator by the denominator. I'm just going to do this to remind some of you who possibly have forgotten how to do the following. So we're dividing 5s squared plus 3s plus 2 by the denominator, which is s squared plus 2s plus 3. So what we do would get this leading expression of S here and divide the leading one here, which will give us 5. And then multiplying 5 by this, we get 5s squared plus 10s plus 5. So subtracting here, we get -7s - 30, which will be our remainder. So what we have here is a mixed algebraic fraction, which will be 5 plus. So we have here 5 plus this rational expression. This exactly plays the role what we saw before, where we had 7 over 4. So we divided there, we got a 1, which actually whose role is played by 5 here, the whole number, plus a remainder, which is 3. In this case here, the remainder, which is -7s - 3. Then we write here 3 over 4. That's exactly the kind of structure we've got here. Once we've got this thing now, we've got now a proper algebraic fraction, in the sense that the power of s in the numerator is 1 and the power of s in the denominator is 2. So it becomes a proper fraction. In order to expand this into partial fractions, at this point you must now double check if we can be able to factorize this kind of expression. Like we've seen before, if we cannot be able to factorize, the second option will be to try to complete the square. And from the previous example, we saw what has led us to. So that's what we must do. According to what I've checked here, this is not possible to factorize. So we'll now proceed and complete the square. But remember, we said the process of completing the square is done in the expression for s here, whereby we need to take half the coefficient of the linear term, which in this case will be 2 over 2, which is going to be 1. Then the next thing will be to square this half, then square 1. And once you've squared that 1, then you add and subtract to this expression of s the square of 1. But in this case, in this particular case, we don't need to do that at the moment, because we see that the square of 1 is 1. In that case, we can just borrow a 1 from 3 here to write this quadratic expression as s squared. So we get this denominator written as follows. As you can see, this is 3. But then this up to there, we know that's a perfect square, which would actually be factorized as follows: s plus 1 squared plus 2. And then, which means here, we have to follow this up and now get 5 -7s + 13 all over s plus 1 squared plus square root of 2 squared. If you look at what I'm doing here, I'm already now at this stage, you can see that I've already sort of noticed that we are coming back to a similar situation to Laplace transforms of sine and the cosine. That's why I'm writing this as square root of 2 squared, so that we've got our omega being equal to 2. And then again, what we're going to do now here, we have got now to split this into two parts, because as you can see, we're going to get a version of a sine Laplace transform and another version of a cosine Laplace transform. So we move on as follows. So splitting this rational expression into two, we get the following. So now what we now have to do is to adjust this expression of s in the numerator here, and equally think of how we can get our corresponding omega in the numerator here. In this case, we've got to take 13 out here as a factor multiplying a Laplace transform, and equal here 7, we're going to do exactly the same thing. Now we note two things here. If we're to try to strike some similarity between this transform and the cosine Laplace transform, which we know it as it should be s over s squared plus omega squared, that transforms in the time domain as cosine omega t. Cosine would have omega over s squared plus omega squared, which we know it transforms in the time domain as sine omega t. So when we're dealing with these problems, this always must be in our mind, otherwise we are going to overlook a lot of things. So now we're simply trying to shape these two in the similar way, so that we can then determine what the functions are. And of course, because of what we are seeing here, and of course involve the exponential shift theorem, which we have seen before. The adjustment we're going to make here, because we see that there is s and there is s squared. So now we've got s plus 1 here. We should also have s plus 1 in the numerator. So that we're going to solve as follows. We're going to add here a 1 and a subtract a 1, which basically s plus 0, which is s. So we haven't done anything illegal there. And then here, in this case here, what we need actually here is omega, but we've got a 1. But fortunately, we can see here, according to this, our omega would be square root of 2. So what we need to do now, we would now have to take this 1 and write it as square root of 2 over square root of 2. I've talked about this before. If I've got A over B all over C, this will always be equals to A over B C. So take your B to be the square root of 2 here in the denominator, and take this fraction as a numerator there. This fraction, which is actually equivalent to 1, take it as a numerator there and do exactly this same thing, and this is what we're going to have. For this part, starting this part, we're going to split this into two. This denominator with s plus 1, and this same denominator with minus 1. Then we've got the following. So this is what we've got now. After splitting this into two and substituting 1 by this, then we've got square root of 2 there, and now we've got omega there and omega squared there. Then I note that if we remove the brackets here, we've got to multiply this and that there. And again, here, we can actually do a similar adjustment using the same equivalence of 1. Adjusting this, we've got 5 minus in brackets 7 multiplied by this expression, which is clearly a Laplace transform of a version of cosine omega t. And this is sine, and that is sine. And you can see these are two like terms. I hope you understand that this square root of 2 here is the same use of this, then the numerator to get to that. So now we just have here 13 minus 7, which will give us 6. So then what we now have here is simple, the following simple expression. And we can actually now even involve this minus sign here. So I'm going to have here 7 in brackets s plus 1 all over s plus 1 squared plus omega squared. And now remember, when you simplify this, we get 6 over square root of 2, then multiplying by, and now we are simplifying this term, we said we're going to get 6 here, which is simply going to be minus 6 over square root of 2, because remember this minus here affects the whole bracket. So we've got 6 over square root of 2, square root of 2 over s plus 1 squared plus square root of 2 squared. So this is the Laplace transform we have managed to get. So in other words, now we have managed to decompose the given rational expression into the following form. So that's what we can take now to our solution. So now our side discussions and calculations have given us this kind of decomposition of the given rational expression here. So now there's nothing else we can do now except to now to refer to the table, which I'm not going to do now. You've got the table. I'm just going to do it straight away. What we've got to take into account, we see that this is the version of the Laplace transform, which is an s over s squared plus omega squared, which we know it will give us cos omega t. We've seen that. And then this one is simple, an omega over s squared plus omega squared, which should give us a sine omega t. So all what we need to do here now is that we need to apply the exponential shift theorem, which we know as that if we're given an e tau t of a time signal, this will transform to simply capital X of s minus tau. So your task now is to initial this. You have to identify what is your tau. That's simple. You just have to try to reveal this minus sign by taking plus and then doing it and writing s plus 1 and writing it as s minus minus 1. So in that situation, if you compare with this, then it's a simple say now your tau is equal to minus 1. So now to determine the time domain signal now, it's now as easy as simple writing. Therefore, R of t, note that R here is playing the role of x here in the theorem. And then we look at each term one by one and write the time domain signal. Now note, here we've got 5, but remember 5 is equal to 5 times 1. And we know that 1 is actually the Laplace transform of the impulse function delta t. That's what we know. If you go to the table, you see exactly that. So which means now, we're in the frequency domain, and in the frequency domain we multiply by 5, and the Laplace transform is linear. So what we're going to have here was simply going to have here 5 multiplied by delta t, the impulse function. Then minus, we've got a 7 here, which is a constant again. And then looking at that expression, we compare with that, you will see that this is a cos square root of 2t. And because of this, we apply the exponential shift theorem, then this will be e to the power minus t. And then moving forward now, we're going to come to this one and have minus 6 e to the power minus t for the same reason, all over square root of 2. And this is a version of a sine function which needs an exponential shift theorem like we've indicated here. Then you've got here sine square root of t. Let me recognize this and write it as minus here, that and changes to plus, and put here ut, just again to emphasize that this is a causal signal. So at that point, that will be the end of the solution or the process of inverting this Laplace transform into the time domain. So we migrated now from the frequency domain to the time domain signal using what we call the inverse Laplace transformation. So I hope this is giving you the idea of how we deal with this kind of expression. You can see that this particular example had to take you to division, and also then take you to the decomposition of the rational expression into its partial fractions, and then these kind of manipulations again to be able to blend at a time domain signal. So what is left now is actually in your hands to do relevant practice in order that you gain experience and maturity in this kind of work. For your practice, then I've already given you this list of exercises, and the example you've just looked at is actually addressing the issues involved in number 6 and 7. So the rest now is for you to engage all these exercises and gain relevant experience. Otherwise, at this point, I'd like to say thank you for listening. My name is Charles Suwazifane Msi.